morning. Welcome to Community Church of Vincennes, and we are very appreciative of your attendance here today, or if you're online watching us. It is truly a blessing to be able to worship Jesus Christ our Lord today. We want to mention, first of all, Jim has brought his crew here from Sanborn Church, and we are truly blessed that they've made the trip, and we hope that as we mingle among each other, that we lift each other up in spirit and in praise. Also, Lord, also there's an announcement for Mary Martha's. There will be a meeting, a brief meeting, which is unusual, right after church. They will be meeting in the prayer chapel. Sorry about that. I just couldn't resist. We're going to have a word of the week video. And so let's play the word of the week video.
Well, 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 what do we have here? Just as I thought. Another believer not wearing the armor of God. I'm Pastor Darren, and I'm bringing you your word for the week. And I want to remind every one of you, no matter where you live around the world, that we all need to be wearing the full armor of God. In Ephesians chapter 6, in verse 10 through 12, we're told this: "Finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by his vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, and against evil, against these spiritual forces of the heavens." We must be prepared. And that means you and I need to take some time this week and think about putting on the full armor of God. We need to put on the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes prepared with the gospel of peace, the helmet of salvation, and of course, the sword of the Spirit. God avenges all things, but he does call on us to be prepared to enter into the battle. Be prepared to stand against the fiery darts of the evil one, and be prepared to share that good news, the gospel of peace, with everyone you can. Think about it and pray about it. I'm Pastor Darren. That's your word for the week, taking it to you and to all those around the world. God bless, and have a good day.
What I do in my off time. All right, we're going to move right into our first song, Days of Elijah. So as you are able, let's stand and join together, shall we?
These are the no God like Jehovah. There's 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 no God like Jehovah.
Regarding the armor, every morning when my daughter leaves for school, I tell her goodbye, I love you, have a good day, stick with Jesus, and armor up. And we actually go through some prophetic moves of putting on the helmet and the belt and the shoes and the breastplate and taking up our sword and shield. And it's a prophetic act. I mean, we can't see it, but our enemy can, and we know it's there. So, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And how many of you know praise is a weapon?
Amen.
Praise is a weapon. And so we're going to praise the Lord. We enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. And we're going to come into his presence this morning because he's already here. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, there's been a lot this week that we're all dealing with, and we thank you for your goodness, but we also want to lift up some concerns. We've got so many losses for our church family, and the Chatton family, Lord, just keep them close and protect them all in their grief. And the Flory family, we're thankful that Phil's here back from a heart attack, and can't hold him down, so we praise God for healing. Judy Duell's granddaughter, who's experiencing a major health concern, and we just speak life over that in Jesus' name. Brad Williams for his hip surgery, and Melvin and Linda continue to deal with a lot of things, and we just speak life and wellness over that. Amy Blake's father has passed away, and so the funeral arrangements are pending. And Lord, in all of those grief situations, we speak your protection, your presence over that, for healthy grief, for safety, as those doors and their hearts are open. Father, we just praise you because you are a good God. You are a good God. There is none like you. You are more beautiful than all. You are precious to us. You are kind and loving, and you stepped down out of heaven to come and get your kids back, and we love you, and we can't repay that. The only thing we can give you in return for that, it's not necessarily our hearts, it's our obedience. We come into obedience, for you have come to redeem us, and we love you. We thank you for all that you are, and we ask your blessing upon this service. May it bless your name, may it bless your children, and serve the purposes of the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen. All right, so what we're going to be doing this morning is dealing with redemption. We all know somebody somewhere, maybe it was even in our own hearts, where we have done something, said something that we think is unforgivable. Or we know those people who said, well, I can't go into the church because if I do, you know, the roof will fall in or something like that. In other words, they feel like they've gotten so far away and they're just so lost that there is no point of that they can be redeemed at, that they're just, they have settled into that idea that, well, this is the way it is and I'll live, do I die, and that'll be that.
You know, they've kind of given up on any sort of hope that they have. This message is about reminding us that that's not the way it is. Like this canvas up here, we start off kind of just blank. There's nothing going on. God created us, and pristine, if you will. We were created in that way. If we go back to the very beginning until, of course, the fall, that's when things started going south. But no matter what mess that happens in our lives, no matter what's been going on, no matter what weird thing has happened, no matter what sin we've committed, God has a way of being able to redeem that, to take that which has been defaced and turn it into something good. And if you've ever experienced that transition in your life where God took a terrible thing and turned it into something great, then you know what we're talking about here. So today we're going to look at this, and you have the blessing of being able to be here and worship and watch paint dry. That's what's going to happen here. And you have to forgive me, I got a bit of a cold going on here, but we're gonna get some help up here. So I've asked Gray to come up. Gray, can you come up here a minute, buddy? We're gonna let him put the first bit of paint on this here today. Now, I've already instructed him. I'm gonna give him the brush. He's got a selection of paint. He can just throw some splotches up on here. He's not supposed to paint anything, but just there you go. Grab, dip a little bit of paint in there. You pick any color you like. You like the red one? I was thinking you might do that. All right, where do you want it? Put it up on there. Okay, is that good? You gonna do any more with it? All right, very good. Thank you much. Let's give Gray a hand. You got big old dab on there. That'd take 3 days to dry there. All right, with that, so let's go to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3 through 6. This is where we kind of begin. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him. So understand this. And again, if this is something you already know deep in your heart, this is something that we can share with other people, okay? That he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. So there's God's, this is his desire. He wants us to be holy as he is holy. He talked about it in the Old Testament. He talks about it in the New Testament. Be holy because he is holy. So he wants us to be blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ. So this is what God has intended for us. This is what he wanted his creation to be. It does not mean that someone is destined and can't fall out. This is what I planned. But each of you have a choice to follow me. And for those who choose to follow me, there is eternal life. For those who choose not to, well, there's eternity in the lake of fire. But when he's talking about this destination, this was his original plan. This is what he wanted everybody to be because, and we'll hear this later on, for all are called, but few are chosen. You know, many are called, few are chosen. And that's only because they have chosen to walk away. But we want you to know there is hope. So he destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. This is what Jesus has done for us. He has made it possible for us to be his children. So we're going to take a few moments here and see what we can't do with what God has in store for each and every one of us in Christ. We all have those moments where we have fallen short, amen? And the one nice thing about God in Christ is he knows where we've been. He knows the things we've done. We can't hide it from him. And as much as we might be embarrassed by it, as much as we might be ashamed of it, God knows it's there. And he loves us anyway. That was Jesus' whole purpose. He wanted us to know him. He wanted us to be saved. And so he walks with us. Some would even say he talks with us. And he says we're his friend. Now, we had a fellow over here by the name of Matt that was real good at doing stuff like this. Steps, don't fall. Now, Matt did great big paintings. I don't do great big ones. But you know what? One of the great things is, even though there is a price to be paid for our sin, Jesus was gracious enough to pay that price for us. And that is our next song. And I'm going to ask the worship team to share that with us now. If the kids would like to come up here, Dana's got a little something to share with you this morning.
In Ty and hey, Jared. Hello.
No,
good morning.
She goes to Franklin and I go to Franklin.
Okay.
Yep.
Oh, well, good. But let's get to our lesson, okay? Okay. Hi, Reagan. So, I'm going to try to tie this in to Pastor Darren. Do you like what he's been doing with painting? And he's still painting up there. Isn't that cool?
It looks like water and...
No. Dark mountains or like hills and...
It
oh,
looks
my
like
goodness.
A beautiful sky and some hills.
Isn't it?
But
so,
there's a big turn in there.
Oh, no. I don't think so. So... He started out with a blank canvas, and I've got papers for you. I'm giving each of you a paper, and you can take it with you. And if there's time in prayer and praise, or I'll tell you, I'm going to, on this side. Well, I don't know. It's the other side, Reagan. There. And there's a reason. I'm going to talk more.
Why is there a mug?
That's what we're going to talk about. So, if you have time in prayer and praise, but if not, you can take them home.
The black matches my hair.
Oh, it sure does. So.
Or it could be bling them in class.
So, yes, you could. So, what do you notice about this paper? Some of you have already said. Everett, what do you notice about your paper? It's okay, but what? Yeah, scribbled. Is it the way you want a paper to look when you get a piece of paper to draw on? Is that the kind?
No.
Or would you rather have something like this to draw on?
Like that.
Yeah, you always want that. That's already started. Well, this is charcoal, actually. And so one thing that I noticed, it kept coming off. But, so we want this. But our canvas, and I know this is paper, but our canvas isn't starting out blank. Our canvas is starting out with something that doesn't look so good. It's like messy, or you might even say it's kind of dirty. Does it look kind of dirty?
Yeah.
So how about our lives? Is there anything about your lives that maybe is messy? Can you think of something in your life? Everett? Sin, yeah, but I'm wanting you to name names. I'm wanting examples. So this...
A baby?
Babies throw food, yes.
I know
what?
Messy.
Yes, but what messy? What's something you've done to make this... This is the canvas of your life. This is your life, yeah? Lying. Maybe somebody said,
saying cuss words.
Who did this?
Saying cuss words.
Well, that's a good one, saying cuss words. So see?
Saying bad words.
It's all dark. And look, I'm doing this, and it keeps coming off. And it's not clean. But that's the way our lives are. Our lives, see each of these, Reagan. It's the same thing, each one for each one here. If I gave one to everybody here, they wouldn't be a white canvas to start out with, would they? What could we do to clean the canvas up to make it so that it was white as snow? We kind of just sang.
But what? You know, like, play games on your PlayStation that are not shooting games?
Well, that's a good start. I'm meaning something else. That's a great thing to do practically.
Are we still going on the messy because I know one?
Yeah. Yes.
I know one on the messy.
Okay.
Bullying,
oh boy, that's for sure. Yeah, that's for sure. Just smarting back to your mom is a big one. Yeah. Yeah, what? Yeah, I don't know.
Is this real paper?
It's real paper, and you're going to take it with you. So, what can we do? We're still thinking. I know some of you know, but you just don't know what I'm trying to get at. What can we do that would cover our sin? To put it in other words, Everett. To cover our sin. So, okay, we can go with that. We can use an eraser. There we go. Confess with your mouth. Boy, I'm just like making all kinds of noise. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and say that God raised him from the dead. That's what the Bible tells us. And you know what he would do with this? It's there.
It would change our life.
He would cover. So what I'm going to do, and you can cover this whole paper, I'm just going to take this little bitty thing. See, this is what God did with it, or through Jesus. What is that?
A heart.
Yeah. So that's what it would be, that Jesus, when we ask Jesus to forgive us, and we say, we believe in you, and he can take the messiness of our lives, and just like you're going to take this with you and color it, and you can color it solid, you can think, wow, this is what Jesus is doing to my life. He's covering all the sin in my life.
Look,
yeah. Yeah. So can you remember that? Yes.
Cover and change. It's the same thing because Jesus changed your lives and change.
Yes, he will. He will cover up all of our old sin. Yeah. And by saying cover up, I mean it doesn't matter what you do if you tell God that you're what?
That's a crime.
Yeah. If you tell God what, then he'll forgive you. What do you tell God?
I'm sorry.
Can you sit up here?
I'm sorry for my sins.
There we go.
They're black.
Yeah, I know. There's some black in there. So before you go to prayer and praise, we're going to have a prayer, okay? Can we do that? Can we do that? I will say and then you say. Okay, let's repeat after me, please. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
We thank you.
We thank you.
That you will forgive us.
That you will forgive us.
For anything we have done.
For anything that we have done.
If we confess.
If we confess.
That we have done it.
That we have done it.
And ask for forgiveness.
Ask for forgiveness.
And try really, really hard. To not do the same thing.
To not do the same thing.
We ask all of this.
We ask all of this.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, now you can go back to prayer and praise.
I thought it was amen.
It's both. Okay, can you go?
People do amen and amen.
I know both of them. Isn't that right?
Well, I'm going to ask Rex to come up and share a few things. He's ready.
For those who feel they have done something so bad that God cannot forgive them, these words are for you. For those of us who some tragedy or trial or loss has come upon our lives and the Lord seems too far away, or perhaps like Job's friend said, I've done something, and now the Lord doesn't love me. Hear these eternal and powerful words of hope as the Lord gave them to us through the Apostle Peter. 2 Peter chapter 3, beginning in verse 9. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but all come to repentance. But the day of the Lord shall come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works shall be burned up. Consider the Apostle Peter. In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 22, these are the words of Jesus, and I quote them, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me." That is what Jesus told Peter. That would make you feel unforgivable. And also in all four Gospels, it is recorded where in Jesus' desperate time of need, Peter denied him three times. times. And yet, Peter came to the understanding that Jesus is not willing that any should perish, but all come to repentance, repentance from sin, and repentance from that attitude that Jesus doesn't love me anymore. And so I ask you this morning, if Jesus is not willing that you perish, why should you be willing to perish? Today is the day of salvation. Peter tells us, the Lord tells us, that the Lord is not slow and he is not patient about his promise to save you, but it also says that Jesus is coming like a thief in the night. And believe me, our family knows when a 21-year-old young man goes to work in the morning and doesn't come home. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the hour. This is the time. And also from Romans chapter 3 and verse 21, the words of Paul. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ, for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. I invite you to consider Paul this morning, standing before young Timothy, writing to young Timothy. Paul wrote these words as the blood of the martyrs was upon his hands, and the desperate conviction of his guilt. He wrote these words. Jesus came to the world to save sinners, and among them I am the chiefest. If Paul, who was the chiefest of sinners, who led sinners in the persecution of Christians until the blood was upon his hands and the guilt was on his part, if he said the righteousness of God is apart from the law and he can be saved, what is the message? The message is we cannot ever be good enough by God's law to get to heaven. In fact, we cannot even be good enough to be considered for salvation. What is the message? That Jesus loved us so much that he reached out his arms upon the cross. He did not have to be crucified, but he willingly took Paul's sins, as bad as he was. He willingly took Peter's sins, as bad as they were. He took my sins, my heartache, my failures, my despair, and he nailed them to the cross. And if I give him my sin and my failure, he will forgive. He died and he was risen for you because he loves you. And you are never beyond his reach. So I invite you this morning to realize that God loves you, that God is not willing that you perish, but that God would lovingly give you his righteousness. He would justify you on the day of judgment, and he would give you a victorious heavenly home for eternity.
Shelley, do you have something that you could buy? Thanks. So before salvation came through Jesus, there was a message in the wilderness to repent. And as we are struggling in our wilderness, often the way we get back from that is to repent. And I think we all probably have something in our hearts or on our minds today. I know sometimes when I think I'm doing good and I'm doing better, then I find out, oh, I didn't even know that was a sin. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, Lord, forgive me. And so there's so many things that we see in our culture that we normalize, that we think are okay, and we come to an awareness of the Lord. So let's go to him and repent. Let's take our hearts to him in obedience. Lord, we just honor you. We give you all thanks, praise, glory, and honor because your mercies are new every morning. You give us beauty for ashes, and every morning is a new opportunity. Every moment is a new opportunity to stop and become aware and say, I chose poorly. That wasn't what I wanted to do. That wasn't what I should have said. That's not the way I want to be. I'm to take on the mantle of Christ. I'm in a process of becoming more and more and more like him and less and less and less like my flesh. Father, we stop in this moment and we praise your name and we thank you for the opportunity to come to you, to just turn. And we can be sorry. We're sorry. I'm sorry all the time. But sorry is not good if I don't repent. Being sorry is the beginning of that. We turn from it. We learn. We do better the next time. But we turn from those things. We've got to learn to love what you love and hate what you hate and walk in that every day. To do so in love and truth and peace and kindness, but in strength and truth that you mean what you say and you say what you mean. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the gift of salvation. Father, right now we're just going to take a moment. I'm going to give you guys a chance to speak to him in a silent time, to offer up your repentance to the things that you know or suspect that you may need to. And it is, it may be something years back. But to give him your burden and give him your sin and let him cleanse you of that. Father, your glory will endure forever. We praise your name that you're not sitting on the throne fretting about what's going on in the earth, that the battle is won. The victory is ours, and we choose you. We choose life. Forgive us of our sins, Lord. Forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us from that and give us right hearts. Renew in us a right spirit. And let us walk forward in forgiveness. Not looking back. You don't look back. But give us right hearts to do better, to be better, to speak your praise. Forgive us for not being more bold in our witness of you, of telling people about Jesus, about not taking those opportunities. Help us do better. When someone comes along our path, did we shy away? Did we not want to make waves? Did we not want to be controversial? Forgive us for not speaking truth. Let us be bolder in our witness. People are depending upon us. You're depending on us. You filled us with your spirit when we said yes to you. And we are to take you places. We're to take you to people. We're to take you to things and show who you are to the world. I don't know how good a job we do at that all the time, but Help us do better. Forgive us our trespasses. Help us to be more forgiving and live in the example that you've set through Jesus. We love you. We're grateful. And the best way to show that is in right living. Praise be to your name. And thank you. I felt that shift. Thank you, Lord. Praise be to your name. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I want you to think about that for a moment. What does that look like in our lives when we're living in that redemption? What does it look like when we know what it is to be forgiven and to live in that every day? And then what does that look like when we share it with our family, when we share it with our friends? Is it something we keep to ourselves, or is it something that we want other people to experience? Life can be messy. Rarely is it not. And like any kind of painting, it always looks the worst before it ever gets better. And it's all about that continuing and ongoing refining that God's doing in our lives. He loves us, and he wants us to be better, but we want to be able to give him room to do that. So let's take a look at, let's sing, as we think about that, let's sing In Christ Alone.
Christ alone. My God.
Amen. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
All right. Now, we want to make time for our offering this morning. So I'm going to ask Shelly just to play something and give all of you a chance to bring your offering down. And for those who don't know, we just bring it down here and put it in these plates. There's one up there. So as she plays and as I paint, let's go before the Lord and give unto him of our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we do give you praise for all that you give, the great bounty with which you have filled our days, our lives. And Father, we just offer you this offering. May you bless it, multiply it to your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. Now we're going to ask Mr. Rex to come. Oh, let's see. Wait, I'm going to share. I get it. Okay, so moving along here in Ephesians, we're going to pick up in verse 7 of chapter 1. It says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. So here's where it all comes down. The blood of Christ shed for you and me. And in my own life, that was a major deal. When as a teenager, 17 years old, and I realized somebody was willing to die for me, an arrogant, mouthy, nasty little guy who had committed all kinds of crazy sins, and yet God was willing to die to send his son so he could die for me. Man, that's a big deal. Oddly enough, one of the things I wondered at that time, and a few of you know this because I've shared it before, is I wondered, does the church know? Because my experience at church up to that point was not filled with people that knew they were saved. Because you didn't see what I didn't see. Now, what they felt is entirely different, but what I did not pick up from them was how happy they were, how free they were, how exuberant and excited they were for God and Christ and whatever he was doing for them. I didn't see it. But I want us to be able to know that. The forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and insight. He has made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ. In other words, the Old Testament talked of a Savior. They talked of one to come, but no one knew who he was. And it wasn't until Jesus made his appearance. And, of course, since then, we know this is the mystery. There's no longer, well, who is it? When will it be here? We know he was here, and he's still around. So this mystery has been revealed to us according to the pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. And that includes us. We want to be a part of that, and we want to make sure our family is a part of that, our friends and our neighbors. In Christ, we also have obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things, according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. So if we are saved, if we are redeemed, we should let our faces know so that other people will see it. Amen? In him, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, have believed in him and were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. So God wasn't just about making promises. God was about, when you accept my son, I am going to put my spirit in you. A personal part of me, a personal part of Jesus is going to be in that personal part of you, to remind you of what he said, to help us, to guide us, to equip us, to strengthen us, to give us the gifts that we need to do the things he wants us to do. So we have all the power and strength and ability, all the means necessary to be the body of Christ if we just take hold of it and enjoy it and be that redemptive thing that God is creating so that others can experience it as well. He sealed us with the promise of his Holy Spirit. This is a pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people to the praise of his glory. So get the Holy Spirit, think of it this way, it's a deposit of the glory yet to come in eternity. When it's all finally revealed and we are fully set in him, that's what we're looking for. Let's sing, Spirit of the Living God. Just to play a little bit. I want you to think. I want you to pray. I want you to watch. See what God's telling you. See what God is reminding you of and speaking to you.
as Paul heard it in these words recorded in Galatians chapter 2, beginning in verse 19. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Truly, the Spirit of the Lord is in his house. And as Christ willingly stretched out his hands, was nailed to the cross for your forgiveness, this morning he is stretching out his hands to you who feel unforgivable, who feel that Christ is not there. I testify to you as one who was one day fearful to come to the Lord, fearful of what the Lord might ask me to do, and rather it was what the Lord would do for me. Hear the testimony of one who felt the Lord had abandoned him, felt that the cross to bear was too heavy. Hear the invitation of the Lord today. Whether you feel unforgivable, whether you feel broken, the invitation is out of love from one who shares your tears, who will take your doubts and give you strength. I invite you to come to him today. His arms are open. His love fills his house. Is the Spirit saying, come to me, weary one? Is the Spirit saying to you at home, you are forgivable? The invitation is yours. The significance is eternal. Feel, respond to the loving call of the Lord. Jesus says, come, stand for me, and I will say, well done, good and faithful servant. One day, enter into the joy of your salvation. The choice is ours, the joy of salvation or the eternal separation of the Lord.
What are the things that God is speaking to you today? What is he reminding you of? How has your life changed because of what you know Jesus has done?
Tells us that yesterday is gone. Tomorrow may not be yours. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the hour to say, yes, Jesus, I come.
You know, painting covers many things, but what really draws our eye towards things There's that contrast between the dark and the light. And sometimes you don't know how dark something is until you see it next to something lighter or brighter. God provides for us that light in Christ so that we can see what he's doing. We can see where he can take something that was very dark and he can infuse it with light and life. And create in us something we never expected. But the good news is, he can do it, and he will do it, if we just but let him. What looks to be one thing in one moment turns out to be something entirely different in the next. And we just give God a chance to do what God does best. Little highlight in our life, the blood of Christ that sets us free from all things. That takes something tragic. Something just difficult or hard and turns it into something amazing. Well, there goes that. We've all been through rough waters. Some of us know what it's like to be lost. But those blessings, when we realize that God was there the whole time, waiting for us, watching us, providing for us. There's something we don't always think about. That even when things seem odd and out of place, that God's still there. Just like a little movement of the brush, times just that one little dab changes everything. One of the other things that happens is because of all that Jesus did for us, somebody somewhere in our life took time to share that with us. Our job is to also take some time and share that with somebody else, to let that branch out a little bit. So that others can see and experience those blessings of God. Shadows, light, all mixing together. To give us shape so that we are able to be everything God wants us to be. I don't know if I can pull this off here or not, but let's try this. Kind of like many other things in our lives, we're also an ongoing piece of work. Trust me, I've been called a piece of work on more than one occasion. Everything shifts, everything moves. The moment you think it's going to be one thing, God does something different. house should have a little bit of light in it. And that's the light that Christ provides for us. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Now, just a couple of things, and we will call this done.
There's an atmosphere here that I don't want to interrupt. My grandmother was a painter, and her name was Helen Keller, so that was always kind of funny to me. But I think what's amazing is to paint, you have to really know what things look like. And when we go out into the world and we take the light of Christ with us, and we see situations that we don't like, or we are around people whose behavior we would rather not be with, this is how God sees them, as their finished product, the end deal. Not what we're looking at, not what we're seeing. He sees what he made them to be, and they're stuck somewhere. So we have to see how God sees. We have to know how he looks at things, that he sees them, what they really look like. I struggle with that. I don't know about you guys. God forgive me. I struggle with that. He sees where things went wrong. We see the end product. And it's often things that we don't, you know, that do kind of hit our souls uncomfortably. But praise God, we get to see with new eyes, and we see the end vision, and we have to help others get there too. So, thank you, Jesus.
Amen to that. Amen to that. Thank you. And I do want to give everybody thanks that were taking part in today's service and helping out with all of this. As you can imagine, it's not always as in life. Everything else is not always easy either. But we have what God is doing. The blood of Christ makes it all possible. Little highlights of what Christ is doing in our lives. And when he's done, he will say, well done, good and faithful servant. And we can give him the praise. We can give him the glory. And we can share that good news. With all of those around us. when it's done, when we are done, when God has had his way with us, he signs his name on that which he created and that which he redeemed. Let's pray. Gracious and mighty God, Lord, where we have fallen so much, to know that we are unworthy, and yet Jesus gave his life for us. And you could take something that at first seemed unrecognizable, unredeemable, and turn it into something that's beautiful in your sight. You redeem creation, you redeem us. And that marred image of you that we were in our sin has been restored. And our hearts are grateful. We're thankful, Father, for the inspiration. We thank you, Father, for the hope that you are filling us with even now. And that the angels of heaven are celebrating and giving praise for the hearts and lives that are changing, for those that are experiencing that hope, that renewal, that redemption. Thank you, Jesus, for saving each and every one of us. And Lord, help us to take that which you have restored and share it with the world. Your love, your grace, Jesus, your Son, and his great sacrifice for us. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Let's hear that last song here as we give God praise for what he's doing.
Smile to you.
Thank you, thank you. We give God praise and glory, yes. Yes, for those that don't know, there's coffee and donuts back in the fellowship hall, so if you go around either side, you will find it there. We hope to see you there. Thank you. God bless you. And now may the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you now and forevermore, knowing that you have been redeemed. Amen.
Let my life hold me.